And as you know, the North has been threatening a missile launch, even a nuclear war. But so far, their government hasn't followed through on its rather bizarre threats.
And in neighboring South Korea, Christians there have an answer to the crisis in Asia. And despite the current situation, they're hoping for better days ahead. George Thomas has the story from Seoul.
Baek Yong-sam says prayer, not politics, is the only solution for lasting peace on the Korean peninsula.
The winds of politics are always changing in our region, so our focus instead is on God. He is calling us to pray strategic prayers over the nation of North Korea.
Pastor Baek started this church 6 years ago. It sits less than an hour's drive from the most fortified and dangerous border in the world, called the Demilitarized Zone, or DMZ. On either side of the 152-mile zone separating the two Koreas is almost 2 million troops facing each other, ready to go to war at a moment's notice. The U.S. has some 28,000 soldiers stationed here as well.
We are not scared to be here. If we wanted to get serious about praying, we knew we had to move as close as possible to the DMZ.
And the church has been praying around the clock in recent weeks. Since March, North Korea has repeatedly threatened to turn Seoul, Tokyo, and Washington into a sea of fire by launching preemptive nuclear attacks.
I think we should always be concerned when somebody's threatening our homeland and threatening our allies. And it's causing instability in the region.
The U.S. has responded by sending in bombers, stealth aircraft, and ships to the region.
There's no way we can win this game with counter threats. They can out-crazy us. You have to be able to be firm, but also calm.
But instead of focusing on North Korea's cycles of belligerence, Pastor Baek is telling church members to see past the regime's scare tactics.
When North Korea tries to show off to the world that it's dangerous and unpredictable, they are just masking their own inadequacies. The truth is, they are weak, desperately poor, and led by men who want nothing more than to stay in power. This is when we need to pray for them more.
On the streets of Pyongyang today, North Koreans celebrated the 101st birthday of the country's late founder, Kim Il-sung.
While North Korea celebrates the birthday of Kim Il-sung, here in South Korea, thousands are coming to border checkpoints like this one, and they are placing ribbons on them. Some are asking for peace. Others are calling for the reunification between the two Koreas.
Here, not too far from the DMZ, Park Nam-ri and his two sons spent the afternoon peering into North Korea through binoculars.
People are talking about potential war, but I don't think it's that severe. I use this occasion instead to bring my kids here to talk to them about what's going on in North Korea. It may not happen in my lifetime, but perhaps they will one day see the reunification of our two countries. That's my hope.
George Thomas, CBN News, Seoul, South Korea.
There's a book, I don't know if it's still in print or not, called The Aquariums of Pyongyang, and it's one of the most gripping, heart-rending stories of the suffering of a family that actually left Japan to come back to North Korea to try to, you know, be patriotic and part of the system. And what instead of welcoming them, they were accused of being traitors and put into this ghastly gulag. And you just cannot believe what happens to these people, the suffering they endure at the hands of these vicious dictators. And all that the Kims want, what that pastor said is right, they want to maintain power. That's what it's all about. And this is nothing but a big game. But if that game goes too far, the United States has got to be prepared to deal with it forcefully. We cannot allow this group of criminals to parade back and forth on the world stage and threaten everybody. And I'm happy that the Chinese have said, look, we cannot have some group destabilizing the region for their own selfish ends. Well, here at home, there's a shocking abortion trial going on, but that story apparently has been ignored by what would be called the major news media, with the exception of Fox and, of course, CBN. Lee Webb has that story from our CBN newsroom. Lee.
You're right, Pat, and it's not clear whether abortion doctor Kermit Gosnell will testify in his own defense in his murder trial this week. Gosnell is charged with the deaths of 7 babies allegedly born alive and a 41-year-old woman patient. Authorities say the babies were killed using scissors. 8 former employees have already pleaded guilty, some to third-degree murder. 7 other former employees have already been convicted, and prosecutors will call more witnesses this week. The case has sparked an uproar among some conservatives and even some liberals. They accuse big media, as Pat mentioned, of ignoring this story. CBN News will bring you more coverage of the Gosnell trial from Philadelphia. But as I mentioned, Kristen Powers, who's no conservative, Pat, wrote apparently an op-ed piece in USA Today saying that the media better start covering this story. And apparently they listened, and I think some of the big media outlets have indeed started to cover it.
Well, it's like a slaughterhouse. If anybody who was a so-called pro-life advocate did anything, even a fraction of as vicious as this thing, the media would be all over it. But because this makes abortion look bad, then the media doesn't want to cover it. But this is just absolutely horrible what this man was doing. But you know, folks, why is it okay to kill a baby that is 5 months old in the womb and is, he's called a, quote, fetus, and he can feel, he can sense, he would probably be capable of being alive if he was outside the womb. But somehow, according to the way the laws are written, it's okay to kill him. And it's called a legitimate abortion. But once he's born or she's born, then it becomes murder. And so what they were doing, these babies were being born as they are tended to do, and they would take scissors and snip their spinal cords and kill them. And therefore, it becomes murder. Would you please tell me, maybe I'm a little dense, but would you tell me what the difference is, Lee?
Pat, a former Planned Parenthood official in Los Angeles, says the group overcharged the state and federal governments. Victor Gonzalez was the vice president of finance for Planned Parenthood LA. His lawsuit claims the organization is guilty of more than $100 million in overbilling. The American Center for Law and Justice represents Gonzalez. His lawsuit claims that Planned Parenthood affiliates routinely and unlawfully bill the government at higher prices, Pat.
Folks, I've been talking about this along the way. You know, we, of course, sponsored the American Center for Law and Justice, and this is their big case. It is a big, big, big case. There's one just settled in Texas against a small affiliate of Planned Parenthood, and they settled after mediation. The Planned Parenthood has got a very prestigious law firm. Former Attorney General under Jimmy Carter is one of the senior partners of this law firm. And they have thrown up every delaying tactic you can imagine. And what they did was to say, really, these plaintiffs have no standing, and they had all sorts of legal reasons why this case should be dismissed. Well, the district court judge said, we agree with you and we'll dismiss it. So the American Center for Law and Justice appealed to the Ninth Circuit. Now, that is a notoriously liberal panel. But you know something? They agreed. And the government agreed. And so they all came together and they said, no, this case will go forward to trial. So it's getting ripe, as they say, for trial. And there are all kinds of discoveries and motions going back and forth. But it's going to be huge, huge, ladies and gentlemen, this shocking case of triple billing for procedures that this organization performed and billed the government for. Lee?
And we'll continue to follow that case, Pat. In other news, the socialist revolution in Venezuela may continue. Hugo Chavez's handpicked successor won Venezuela's presidential election by just over 1%. But his opponent is not conceding. Charlene Israel has that story.
Officials declare Nicolas Maduro the winner by less than 235,000 votes, the narrowest victory since the 1968 presidential election. Challenger Enrique Capriles says he won't accept the results and is calling for a full recount.
We are not going to recognize any results until each vote of the Venezuelan people is counted.
Crowds of supporters cheered as Maduro spoke from the presidential palace.
We're calling for respect of the results. If they want to do an audit, they are welcome to do it. They can do whatever audit they want to do. We trust in the Venezuelan electoral system. We welcome an audit.
Maduro, a longtime foreign minister to Venezuelan ruler Hugo Chavez, had been acting president since Chavez's death. Chavez died last month after a long battle with cancer. Maduro's victory followed an often ugly campaign in which he promised to carry on the Chavez legacy. Capriles's main message was that Chavez brought one of the most oil-rich nations in the world to the brink of ruin. Venezuela's economy has been in shambles with 22% inflation and power outages along with food shortages. Crime has skyrocketed, the homicide rate tripled under Chavez, and Caracas is now one of the most dangerous cities in the world. And while some of Venezuela's oil money was used to alleviate poverty, a lot of it was used to further Chavez's so-called anti-American revolution. Meanwhile, Venezuelans living in South Florida traveled by bus to New Orleans to vote in the election. Many had hopes for a return to full democracy in their homeland. Charlene Israel, CBN News.
Pat, the question is whether Maduro has the charismatic qualities that his predecessor had and whether he can hold that country together.
Well, Hugo Chavez was a demagogue of the first order, and there are very few that could follow in his footsteps. But, you know, he appealed to the poor, and the poor are not educated. They don't understand what the issues are. And they don't know that the country is falling apart. They're just being told by these people, if you vote for me, I'll get you some bread, or I'll get you electric power, or I'll get you something that you're looking for, clean water or whatever. And all it takes is those promises. And the fact that Chavez is destroying the country through his ill-guided policies and sending billions of dollars, I might add, of their money to Cuba to support Castro's regime, or to Ecuador to support the socialist regime there, or down to Bolivia to support the socialists there. The Venezuelan people didn't know that. And the problem is, we've got it here in America, when you've got people who are not particularly informed about electoral processes, and all they want to know is, what's in it for me? And when you have that kind of selfishness and people realize that they can vote something for themselves out of the public purse, how do you beat it? Well, you don't beat it until after some terrible collapse. So the Venezuelan economy is on the edge of that terrible collapse. Lee?
Some Senate Republicans are breaking from their party to support a measure to expand background checks for gun buyers. But it may not be enough to pass the bill. Senator Susan Collins of Maine said this weekend that she would vote for the compromise plan, and Senator John McCain indicated he might be willing to vote for a gun measure. Right now, though, only three Republican senators are expected to vote for the compromise bill. Senate Democrats need every vote they can get because this week's expected vote is too close to call. Republican Senator Marco Rubio says a new deal on immigration reform does not include any kind of amnesty provision. Rubio is one of the so-called Gang of Eight working on the bipartisan legislation. He said the new immigration plan does not offer amnesty, just another option to what's already available.
All we've done here is create an alternative to that they can access. And the alternative we've created is going to be longer, more expensive, and more difficult to navigate. It will actually be cheaper if they went back home, waited 10 years, and applied for a green card. And so, secondly, we're not awarding anything. All we're giving people the opportunity to eventually do is gain access to the same legal immigration system, the same legal immigration process that will be available to everybody else.
Many Republicans still say the plan effectively offers amnesty, and they will not support the measure. Well, today is tax day. A new survey shows that the tax code is a major burden on America's small businesses. The survey, conducted by the National Small Business Association, it found that 84% of small business owners have to pay an outside tax practitioner or an accountant to handle their taxes. 38% reported they spend more than 2 work weeks a year dealing with federal taxes. The summary adds, just imagine the collective business and job growth that could be done absent that burden. It concludes that the tax code is inherently unfair to small businesses And the time for serious tax reform has come. Weighing in at more than 70,000 pages, the U.S. tax code punishes work, investment, risk-taking, and entrepreneurship. Pat?
Well, that's about as serious an indictment as you could make against any form of legislation. But, you know, it's the playground of special interest. Everybody gets his little deal in there, and it is so complex. There was a time that many, many people did their own taxes. I mean, you sit down and go through all those things, and it wasn't all that complicated. But right now, it's so complex that I read one congressman who himself is a lawyer and a CPA, does not do his own taxes, but must bring in a tax professional, somebody who is spending more time on it than he can. And he's in the organization that writes the laws. It is disgraceful. I remember Jimmy Carter using an old Southern statement, you know, it's a disgrace to the human race. But he said it and people took it right. It was a disgrace to the human race way back then, and it's a whole lot more of a disgrace now. And it's time that they get in. It would be so simple to put in a flat tax, a simple flat tax, and eliminate most of the loopholes and deductions and say, okay, here you've got one or two. You know, Canada, for example, does not have a mortgage interest deduction. No mortgage interest. And there's so many disparities in our business relationship that are caused by unfair taxes. And the complexity is outrageous. It's costing, $500-600 billion a year it takes out of the economy because of the time that is spent figuring out those onerous taxes. But the special interests don't want it, and of course the accountants don't want to change it. The lawyers don't want to change it. Why would H.R. Block want to change it? They make a lot of money making it complex. The more complex, the more work there is for them to do. It's time for a change, but can we get bipartisan support? We hope so. Lee?
And the question is, where's all that tax money we're paying going? Well, we have more examples of government waste. The General Accounting Office looked at how the government duplicates spending. For example, two different programs paid $30 million to inspect catfish. Two arms of the Department of Homeland Security conducted research on finding one chemical, and no one noticed that both were doing the same thing. How much did it cost? $66 million. And the government spent nearly $3 billion on almost 700 initiatives on renewable energy in 23 different agencies. The Fiscal Times points out that Congress has been slow to respond to the GAO's recommendations to cut back on wasteful spending. Washington has addressed only 16 of the 162 identified areas. Gold took another major hit on the financial markets today, falling more than $100 at one point and dropping under $1,400. Gold is down more than 25% since its record high over $1,900 in September of 2011. Silver and other commodities have also fallen dramatically, and oil has gone below $90. Analysts are split on whether the sell-off is over, Pat.
Well, I am split on it, too, because I'm still a fan of gold. But I tell you, this is devastating to those who spent a lot of their money and earnings on gold. And Terry, I'm sure you have an answer.
Sit tight.
Yeah. Play for the long haul. Well, I've been emphasizing over and over again stocks that pay dividend, high dividend stocks. And I really like these master limited partnerships, the MLPs, especially those, well, most of them don't pay taxes and they pay high dividends. And you can get 6%, 7%, 8%, 9% on a regular basis. And gold, as much as I like gold, does not pay any interest or dividends. It just sits there, and you hope it goes up. But the thing that has surprised me has been the strength of the United States dollar. But everything else is so chaotic that people look at the dollar as a haven, and you thought, my goodness, we've got such an inflationary policy here in the United States that they can't possibly be good for the dollar. Well, it has been, and the dollar is still quite strong. And so versus gold, you know, it's holding up against gold. So it just seemed to be totally counterintuitive to hold your money in a dollar account. But it's worked out so far for people that have. But I still say look for high dividends, and they're found in good MLPs, there's some of them that, you know, they process oil, they process natural gas, et cetera. And they get paid whether the price of oil is up or down, doesn't matter. It just flows through their pipelines and their utility takes.
So some consistency there.
Well, you, 89%, good deal. I mean, that Kinder Morgan, Mr. Kidner, has made a fortune on owning a piece of it, but it's been good for him and good for those. And enterprise products gone up. There are a number of these master limited partnerships. There's some of them that are terrible, of course. It'll, mm-hmm. You know, you lose your money, but the good ones, the well-financed ones, have been quite successful, and they've outperformed gold.
Tip for the day.
Well, I don't know if it is or not. I mean, all of a sudden they'll start going down and people say, how dare you?
Pastor Rick Warren and his wife held a private funeral service for their son last week. 27-year-old Matthew Warren took his own life after a lengthy battle with mental illness. Some took the opportunity, though, to criticize Pastor Warren and his son on social media. In a letter to his congregation, though, Sunday, Warren said the family decided on a private service to avoid more controversy and pain. Warren wrote, "The family's grieving has been public, and grieving when haters celebrate your pain has been even more difficult." More than 2,000 people gave their lives to Jesus Christ during Holy Week in the Philippines. They did so in response to CBN's annual TV drama called Shackles. The program features real-life stories of people overcoming life's challenges through faith in Jesus Christ. Shackles aired on Good Friday as well as Saturday, and it reached almost 9 million homes in Manila and nearby provinces. It's now in its fifth year, and viewers say this year's program proved again that nothing is impossible with God. You can find out more about what CBN is doing around the world by logging on to cbn.com/international.